1856. And I read it in English. Franz Liszt referred in a letter to, and now I quote, a mode of playing still customary in some places, a mechanical kind of playing which, meticulously adhering to the meter, splits up the performance by perpetually emphasizing the strong and weak beats. You get that? Yeah? Okay, so he says, a mechanical way kind of metronomic. It is in some places still in fashion, probably in the countryside. And it splits up the performance by emphasizing the strong and the weak beats. So that's what he says about the early music of his time, a way of playing. And of course, he is very much in favor of the new idea of playing the tempo rubato. Right. This period, actually, the time between 1800 and 1850 is very interesting in my view, because it is the time of transition, it's the time of change. Some composers are with one foot in the past and with the other foot in the new world. There is a nice story of Mendelssohn where he apologizes to the orchestra. And he apologizes for having made a ritardando. It says two things. It says, first of all, that it was unusual to make a ritardando. And it says something about Mendelssohn, that he made one, that he was modern in that way. There are more reports on his playing, that he was very flexible in his tempo. On the other hand, Chopin was very strict. In fact, Chopin was very old-fashioned. Chopin told his students, and there are many, many, many reports on that, to play metronomically always. The only thing he allowed was freedom in the right hand. And I have to read what Franz Liszt said about Chopin's rubato. Somebody asked Franz Liszt, how did Chopin play? And he said, sehen Sie diese Bäume an, to see these wonderful trees. Der Wind spielt in den Blättern. The wind is playing with the leaves. Macht sie lebendig. They make them lively. Der Baum bleibt derselbe. The tree does not change. Thus is Chopin's rubato. Wonderful. So it says something about the idea. So the tempo is very steady, that's the tree, and the leaves are making small notes. Okay. Never forget that the tempo of music relates to two important things. Two important human things. First of all, the beat of the heart, and two, the language. So when you speak too fast, people cannot understand you. When you speak too slow, people cannot understand you. When your heart goes slower than 50, you have to go to the doctor. And when it goes more than 180, you should run to the hospital. Right? You know, the first compasses of organs were the same as the compass of the human voice. Right? So the basses to F and the soprano to F or G or A, but not more. Why was that? Just because they only played vocal music on these instruments. They didn't need more. The first metronome goes from 52 to 150. Why is that? That is the human heartbeat scale. You know, that is when you are healthy. Huh? With a bit of extreme to the one side and a bit extreme to the other side. That's why the first metronomes have this scale. The newest Japanese electronic metronomes go to 250. Well, I think if you have a heartbeat of 250, you will soon do not exist anymore. It's too much of the human being. So, speech and heartbeat important. Yes, we get a little bit in trouble. Shall I go on a little bit more?
Well, I'm
too. Or are you bored?
No. Still like 15 minutes.
Oh, good. That's fine. Yes, because I want to speak a little bit about how things developed from the very beginning. I don't think I say something strange when I say that today that there is a disintegration of the tempo, the collective tempo ideas in music making. There are tendencies all over the history, and they are lost today. In fact, I hope I don't stand on somebody's toes, but that the so-called authentic early music movement is responsible for the biggest change in the tradition. The only music where the tradition of what we see in classical music still exists is in pop music. It's interesting. So, Baroque music, steady beat, then comes the period of the tempo rubato, and now we return in the pop music to the steady music of the tempo rubato and pop music at all. In fact, I did research to the pop music in the 60s and 70s, and the ideas of the tempo in pop music of the 60s and 70s is completely similar to the ideas I found in the 16th, 17th, and 18th and 19th century. So there are two main tempos. There is a slow tempo and there is a fast tempo. This is what you find everywhere, also in music of folk music of very many different countries all over the world. And they relate to speech, language, and this. So the main tempos are 60 and 80. 60 is the slow tempo, and 80 is the faster tempo. I mean, as a point of departure. In fact, from the very beginning of music, of instrumental music, people have tried, you know, somehow to document the speed of music, somehow. And one of the most successful ones, very early, is Michael Petrus. I don't know if you have ever heard his name, and he wrote important books, and one of them was published in 1670, and I have to speak about this man with you. Because when music was still only vocal music, when we had no instrumental music, there was a tactus, and the tactus was related to the heartbeat. In fact, there was, if we say it really strongly, there was only one tempo. There were probably small differences, but basically there was only one tempo. Now, Pretorius says in his preface that we have had only one tempo, we have only one tactus, and music has developed so much that we can't do it one. It's not enough. So he proposes to have three different tactus.